Hey, this is the 80 Slasher Librarian, just letting you guys know if you enjoy the content here on the channel and want to support the channel, click on the Patreon link in the description below. As I'm not allowed to monetize the channel here on YouTube, I depend on you guys to keep this channel going and growing by becoming patrons of the channel and sponsoring at the Patreon page. There's great rewards for doing so in tiers as low as $2 to $5 per month.
Hey everybody, it's CJ Graham, Jason, Friday the 13th, Part 6, Hell Cop and Highway to Hell, and the upcoming fan film Vengeance, where I'll be playing Elias Voorhees. That's right, Daddy Knows Best, Jason. Hey, I just want to make sure you guys know you're listening to the 80s Slasher Librarian.
You're with your baby.
Friday the 13th, Part 6, Jason Lives, Chapter 8. Sheriff Garris threw open his car door, reached inside, and grabbed the pump shotgun off the rack. He didn't pause to close the door, but immediately started sprinting in the direction of the gunshots and the screams. As he rounded the corner of the boy's cabin, Nancy came screeching toward him, running in blind panic. He caught her, and the terrified girl started struggling against him, twisting in his grasp and screaming. He held her tight and crouched down, hugging her close to his chest. "Hold on," he said. "Take it easy. I got you. Everything's fine." The noise had awakened all the children. Their faces were all pressed up against the windows, staring down, petrified. The little girls had all come running to the boys' cabin when they heard the screaming start. And as Sheriff Garris entered the cabin, holding Nancy in his arms, they all stared up at him fearfully, not knowing what was going on. Garris put Nancy down and gently prodded her toward the other children. "Kids," he said, "listen to me very carefully. I want everyone to lie down on the floor and stay there. Do not get up until I come back. Now hurry!" The children instantly obeyed, some of them scrambling under the cots, others huddling together in the corners, covering their heads with their arms. Garris lingered only long enough to make certain they were all down on the floor and relatively safe from any possible stray fire. Then he left the cabin, pumping his shotgun as he ran in the direction from which the screams and gunfire had come. He didn't know what the hell was going on, but he had a sick feeling that he had been wrong about everything right from the start. Tommy Jarvis couldn't be responsible for whatever was going on out there in the wind-torn night. Tommy Jarvis was locked up in a cell back in Forest Green. Garris ran hard, his shotgun held before him, ready to be brought into action in an instant. There was no sign of either of his officers. He thought about those gunshots and those bone-chilling, frenzied screams. The wind whipped the trees and bushes all around him, causing him to twitch at every movement, never knowing what could be the wind whistling through the brush or an unknown attacker bearing down on him. There was no sign of anyone down by the lake. Garris surveyed the area quickly, alert for any sign of sudden movement. Nothing. Slowly, he turned and headed toward the shadows between the two cabins, hunkering in a semi-crouch and looking all around him, holding his shotgun at the ready. His eyes strained to see in the darkness ahead of him. Suddenly, his feet struck something and he tripped and fell, slamming down on a soft and yielding mass. It was the body of Officer Pappas. Garris had fallen face down onto the corpse, his nose pressed against the crumpled, bloody skull. There was nothing left of Pappas's face. It looked like a bloody afterbirth. Garris gagged and recoiled from the horror, scrambling up from it in revulsion. He got to his feet, gasping for breath, turned, and came face to face with Jason Voorhees. Garris quickly backed away, adrenaline hammering through his system, his mind racing. They stood motionless, staring at each other. It can't be, thought Garris. It can't possibly be him. He's dead. Jason lunged at him. Garris raised the shotgun and fired point blank at his chest. The blast sent the masked killer flying backward to land motionless upon the ground, flat on his back. Garris exhaled heavily, lowered the shotgun, and approached the body. It sat up. Garris snapped the gun back up, pumped it, and fired again. The blast knocked Jason back down, and he sat up again. With disbelief, Garris fired again three times, point blank, pump, shoot, pump, shoot, pump, shoot. But each time, Jason got back up. It wasn't possible, thought Garris. Nobody could survive that. He tried to fire again, but the shotgun was empty, and Jason was heading for him. A flak vest. That had to be it, Garris thought. The killer's wearing body armor. He dropped the useless shotgun and pulled out his Colt Python. He habitually loaded it half and half. The first three rounds were .38 standard police round nose. The last three were full magnum loads, .357 jacketed hollow points, a round capable of penetrating cinder block. He emptied all six chambers into the killer's face. The bullets entered the plastic mask, punching through it, snapping Jason's head back. But he kept on coming. The bullets had about as much effect on him as a right cross would have on Rocky Balboa. The gun clicked upon an empty chamber, and Garris panicked. He bolted, running for his life, with Jason right behind him. Megan's Camaro roared into the campgrounds and came to a screeching, sliding stop next to the police cars. She jumped out of the car, looking all around for her father. Tommy grabbed the heavy sack from the back seat.
"See?" said Megan, pointing to the cars, feeling relieved. "They did show up. Isn't that great?"
"I hope so," Tommy said, struggling with the heavy sack, not sounding very certain. Megan saw the lights on in the counselor's cabin and started running toward it.
"Megan, wait!" cried Tommy.
Megan ran up to the cabin steps and threw open the door. The stench of death knocked her off balance, and she screamed as she saw the sea of red blood that was coating the floor and smeared upon the walls, dripping down from the ceilings as if the bodies of her friends had been exploded, flinging entrails and viscera in all directions.
"Oh, God! The children!"
She ran toward the cabin as Tommy chased after her, slowed down by the heavy sack. He tried to grab her, but she ran past him, ignoring him, thinking only of the children.
"No, Megan!" Tommy said.
Megan burst through the door, setting off a chorus of screams from the little kids. She stopped scanning the room quickly, as frightened little faces stared up at her from the floor and from underneath the bed.
"It's okay," she said, holding up her hands. "It's me, Megan. Don't be afraid."
Nancy and several of the smaller children ran to her, throwing their arms around her, clinging desperately, frightened out of their wits.
"It's all right," Megan said, struggling to make herself sound calm, doing her best to reassure the children, even while her own heart slammed against her ribs like an animal trying to burst out of its cage.
"Shh, shh." Tommy looked in and heaved a deep sigh of relief. Everything seemed to be all right. He quickly turned and ran back down the steps. He raced toward the dock, struggling with the heavy sack. He ran out upon the plank landing and started to board one of the boats, then recoiled in horror from the sight of Officer Thornton lying flat on his back in the bottom of the boat, eyes glazed with death and blood coagulating around the devil dart stuck in his forehead. Tommy turned away from the dead cop, grimly setting his mind to finish doing what he had to do. He boarded on to the other boat. It had seen better days. The wood creaked in protest as he stepped aboard, and he noticed water puddled at the bottom of the boat. He pressed his lips together. It was gonna have to do. He had no other choice.
He noticed the gas can sitting by the outboard motor, and he checked it quickly. Then he opened up the sack and pulled out a long and heavy 3/8-inch case hardened steel chain. The links clanked as he dumped the chain into the bottom of the boat, then reached into the sack and pulled out several large steel padlocks. Back in the cabin, Megan was doing her best to calm down all the children, trying desperately not to think of the gruesome scene that had confronted her back in the counselor's cabin. Never in her life had she seen or even imagined anything so ghastly, but she closed her eyes and tried to force the horrifying image from her mind. Some of the children were crying. Others were huddling together beneath their beds, curled up into little balls and shivering. A few, like Nancy, had gathered around her, seeking the security of the girl's embrace. Megan clenched her fist, her fingernails digging deep into her palms. She tried to make her voice sound normal, praying that she wouldn't start screaming the moment she opened her mouth. "Now I gotta find my daddy, the sheriff, so we can all go home," said Megan. "Okay?" The children nodded, too frightened to speak. Megan stood up and headed for the cabin door. She paused before going outside.
"So you stay right there, and we'll be back to get you," she said, trying to keep her voice from trembling. "Everyone lie back down, and don't worry."
Two of the kids looked at each other from the floor underneath their beds.
"What do you think?" "I think we're dead meat," they said to each other.
Megan ran outside, looking wildly all around the campsite for her father. "Daddy!" she yelled, her voice breaking.
"Dad, answer me!"
Tommy was struggling with a large and heavy rock, rolling it across the landing near the boat. He had a feeling that Sheriff Garris would not be answering anyone ever again.
"Megan!" he shouted. "Use your dad's car radio and call for assistance and an ambulance!"
Megan stopped in her tracks, staring at Tommy, suddenly realizing what he meant about the ambulance.
"God, no," she thought. "Please, please don't let Daddy be hurt, please."
She ran to her father's car, grabbed the door handle, and yanked the car door open. Sissy's blood-stained head rolled out and landed at her feet. Megan threw her hands up to her face and let out a throat-rending scream.
"Oh, God! Oh, my God!"
She backed away from the car, shaking her head violently, unable to stop screaming. Back in the cabin on the floor beneath their beds, one kid looked to the other, nodding fearfully, and said,
"Okay, really dead meat."
Sheriff Garris could think of nothing but escape. He ran as fast as he could, gasping for air, plunging into the woods, heedless of the branches whipping at his face, thinking only of the thing that was pursuing him, a thing that couldn't possibly be alive, a thing that even shotgun blasts and slugs from a .357 Magnum could not stop. Jason kept right on his trail, walking strong and steady and fast, crashing through the woods after the sheriff, fired by an insatiable need to destroy, urged on by the demon voice in his mind, the voice that exhorted him to run down his prey and kill it with his bare hands. He felt it as a gnawing hunger. He wanted to plunge his fingers into the sheriff's stomach and tear out his intestines, cram them into the man's mouth, and drive them down his throat, smashing his teeth and feeling the warm blood spurting upon his hands. He wanted to rip the skin right off his face, snap all his ribs like they were wishbones, tear his body into shreds, and fling the organs up into the trees where birds could feed upon them. He wanted to bathe in the man's blood, to reduce him to a shapeless, gory pulp, to experience his death, to taste it, to make another sacrifice to the hateful, nameless forces that forever drove him onward, refusing to allow him rest, bringing him back again and again to kill for them. He stopped, the bloodlust pounding through him, listening for the sounds of his prey crashing through the woods ahead of him. He cocked his head to one side, straining to hear, but the sounds of flight had ceased. He hesitated, then started to retrace his steps, feeling his prey hiding somewhere close by, sensing his victim's fear, Sheriff Garris cowered in the bushes, scant inches away. Couldn't Jason hear his pounding heart? Couldn't he smell his fear? Garris held his breath as the beast passed him, lying utterly still, afraid to move a muscle. Then he heard Megan's piercing scream.
Daddy! Where are you? Help us! Answer me! Please! Help!
Jason stopped and listened. Garris didn't breathe. Then Jason started moving once again, grimly, purposefully. Garris peeked out of the bushes and saw Jason stalk by without seeing him, heading toward the sound of Megan's voice.
No! Shouted Garris. Not her!
Forgetting the danger to himself in the face of the threat to his daughter's safety, Garris launched himself from his hiding place. With a roar of rage, he crashed through the bushes and leaped at Jason, tackling him from behind and bringing him down hard. He sat on the killer's back screaming, driving him down into the ground. He rained blows down on Jason with all of his might, pounding him relentlessly, grunting and crying out with each blow, wanting to beat the merciless killer to death with his own bare hands. For a moment, Jason lay still beneath the rain of blows, seemingly succumbing to the punishment. But then his body tensed and he rolled over beneath Garris, looking up at him with loathing, reaching for the enraged man. He ignored the blows and grabbed for his head, forcing it back, bending the lawman's body backward, forcing him further back and down as Garris struggled uselessly. His face contorted with agony. His head was nearly touching his feet, and then there was a loud crack, like the sound of wood splitting, as the sheriff's spine snapped, his back broken in half. Seeing everything before him through a red mist of homicidal fury, Jason threw the sheriff's limp body aside. It fell into the bushes like a bundle of wet rags, and Jason promptly forgot about it as he concentrated on the screaming voice he heard coming from the camp.
You gotta help me look for him,
said Megan, tears streaming down her face as she struggled to help Tommy load the heavy rock into the boat.
We need him to help us.
Tommy ignored her, straining to lower the boulder, bracing himself and trying to ease it down slowly. There was a sharp crack as the heavy boulder landed in the bottom of the boat. Exhausted, Tommy exhaled heavily and bit his lower lip, worrying about the soundness of the little craft.
Okay, he said. Hand me those padlocks.
Megan was hysterical.
Did you hear me?
She screamed at him.
Yes, said Tommy. And I said, hand me those padlocks.
Responding to the commanding tone of his voice, Megan angrily thrust the padlocks at him.
You're gonna be sorry,
she shouted at him. Tommy started to padlock the chain securely around the large rock.
I hope not, he said. He straightened out the rest of the heavy chain and fashioned a noose with it.
Megan was pacing on the dock, utterly disoriented, her eyes unfocused on the edge of complete nervous collapse. There was only so much anyone could take, and the horror of the abattoir inside the cabin, the sight of Sissy's head falling at her feet, the thought of Court with a knife rammed through his skull, and all the rest of her friends dead, all horribly butchered, and now her father. No, her father couldn't be dead, too. What would happen to them if her father had been killed? Who would help them now? Her mind was on the edge of coming unhinged.
Tommy untied the boat and pushed off from the dock, heading out into the choppy water.
Megan! He shouted over the fiercely blowing wind. Get back into the cabin with the kids! She kept stumbling back and forth on the dock, pacing aimlessly, looking all around her in confusion.
Megan, please! Tommy shouted.
She stopped and stared at him for a moment with puzzlement. Then it dawned on her that he was leaving her alone, and panic welled up in her again.
No, wait!
She shouted desperately.
You can't do this!
Tommy turned to start the outboard motor.
Megan! He shouted. Get in there with them before it's too late!
The door of the cabin flew off its hinges, and the children ran screaming,
from the terrifying vision that filled the doorframe, fleeing from the blood-spattered maniac with the burning eyes. But there was nowhere to run. They huddled together, screaming at the back of the cabin. Their worst nightmare had come to life. The sound of the children screaming penetrated Megan's shock. Forgetting her own fear, she ran back toward their cabin, while Tommy stood in the drifting boat, watching helplessly.
Megan, no!
Megan was only a few yards from the cabin when the window exploded in a shower of glass, and Jason came flying through it, landing on the ground before her. She screamed as the powerful blood-stained hands grabbed her head, as the burning eyes bored into her with their maniacal, bestial gaze.
Jason!
The masked face turned toward the sound. Tommy stood up in the boat out on the lake, waving his arms and shouting.
Come on, Jason!
He shouted, goading the killer, desperate to make him forget Megan.
It's me you want! Come and get me!
The image of Tommy Jarvis standing over him, plunging down the iron spear, flashed through Jason's twisted mind, and mindless hate roared through him like a cataract. He threw Megan aside and she fell to the ground, trembling and hyperventilating, hardly able to believe that she was still somehow miraculously alive. Gasping for breath, she got to her hands and knees and looked up to see the children gathered at the shattered window, safe and gazing down at her, wide-eyed and immobilized with fear, though. Something like sanity returned to Megan as she saw the children, scanned their faces, doing a quick head count, and realizing with amazed relief that Jason hadn't hurt them. He had let them live as he had let her live, choosing instead to...
Oh my God, she thought. Tommy!
That's it! Tommy taunted the killer from the boat, waving him on.
Come on, maggot head!
Jason reached the shore of the lake and simply kept going, as if the water wasn't even there, determined to reach the one person he wanted to kill most. He had found the one who had awakened him from his long sleep, the one who had disturbed his rest and brought back all the torment. Tommy sat down in the boat, watching intently as Jason approached. He reached for the chain and noose and held it in his sweating hands, keeping it out of sight, breathing hard as Jason waded closer to him, moving deeper and deeper into the choppy water.
Tommy, get out of there!
Megan screamed.
Row to the other side of the lake! Hurry!
Jason stopped and turned back, looking toward Megan.
No,
thought Tommy, his fury building. No, not Megan, damn it! He screamed at Jason.
Hey, asshole! It's me you want, remember? Come on, chicken shit! I'm sitting here waiting!
Jason turned back toward him, moving through the water like a hungry shark. The level rose up around him as he came toward the boat, moving closer and closer, the water climbing up around his chest. Tommy held the chain noose out of Jason's sight, opening it wider, his hands trembling. He'd have one chance, that was all. He could not afford to blow it. Jason was almost at the boat. The water was up around his neck. The noose was ready. Another 3 feet and... Jason submerged just as he reached the boat, his head disappearing beneath the dark water. Tommy almost screamed. He looked frantically from one side of the boat to the other, scanning the churning water, having no idea where Jason would surface. He waited. Nothing. Panicking, Tommy grabbed the gas can and poured gasoline all around the boat. Then he ignited it. He looked down into the flaming water, searching for any sign of Jason, knowing he would come back up. He saw bubbles rising and leaned out away from the boat, holding the noose over the bubbles. Jason exploded up out of the water on the opposite side of the boat, breaking the surface like a Polaris missile. Tommy lost his balance and fell, dropping the noose. He heard the boat crack. Water started to leak in fast around the rock. Jason grabbed at him, and Tommy struggled to reach the noose. Megan, watching from the shore beside herself, not knowing what to do. She watched the two figures grapple in the boat as the lake around it burned. The gasoline flames leaped up, starting to set the wooden boat on fire, silhouetting the two struggling combatants. Jason grabbed Tommy's jacket, and Tommy thrashed to break free of the grip. The breach in the boat's hull split wider, and water started to pour in. Tommy tried to reach the noose with his foot as Jason pulled him closer. He yanked his arm back hard, causing his sleeve to rip off in Jason's hand. He caught the noose with his shoe and reached for it as the boat rapidly filled up with more water. And then Jason leaped up and his fingers closed around Tommy's leg with an iron grip. Tommy gasped, twisted around, and slipped the noose over Jason's head. Enraged, Jason lunged at him, and the old boat hull split open completely. The heavy rock sank, pulling Jason under with it. But Jason refused to be cheated of his victim. He maintained his grip on Tommy, dragging him down with him, beneath the surface of the lake. From the shore, Megan screamed hysterically. The boulder sank down to the bottom of the lake, its chain pulled taut. Close beside the chain-wrapped boulder, lying in the mud on the lake bottom, was a rotted old sign on which the faded words read, Camp Crystal Lake. Spray-painted over the name was the word blood. At the end of the chain, Jason struggled to hold on to Tommy, refusing to let him go so that he could turn his full attention to the noose encircling his neck. With one hand, he held on to Tommy's leg, while with the other, he vainly tried to loosen the choke chain. Above them, the lake surface burned with gasoline fire. Tommy was fighting desperately to free himself from Jason's grip before his breath gave out. The lust to kill overcame Jason completely, and he abandoned his efforts to loosen the chain and instead pulled Tommy down, clamping his hands around his throat, bent on strangling him to death before he drowned. They thrashed beneath the surface of the lake, fighting to the death. Megan watched helplessly from shore as burning pieces of the boat floated on the lake amid a rising cloud of bubbles. And then the bubbles stopped. She covered her mouth with dread, holding her breath. Slowly, the gasoline flames on the water burned themselves out, leaving only several burning bits of wreckage from the boat drifting on the lake. After what seemed like an agonizingly long time, Tommy's body floated to the surface. Below, anchored vertically by the chain beneath the surface of Crystal Lake, Jason's body drifted like an underwater buoy. Slowly, the children started to come out of the cabin. Megan stood stock still, staring with shock out at the lake, at Tommy's body floating face down on the surface. She was numb. The children came up close to her, surrounding her. It would be morning soon, and the wind had died down to a gentle breeze. Little Nancy saw Tommy floating out upon the lake and stared up at Megan sorrowfully.
"Has he killed him?"
she said softly. Megan blinked, the little girl's voice penetrating through her shock. She turned to the kids.
"Stay here," she said.
She ran down to the lake and dove in, swimming out toward Tommy's motionless body. She reached him and put her arm around his chest, pulling him to the shore. Something grabbed her leg. Megan felt herself yanked down beneath the surface, and she kicked with all of her might, panicking, trying desperately to break free. Her head broke the surface of the water, but Jason still held on to her. She felt herself being pulled down again. She reached out and grabbed the nearest thing, a large floating piece of the boat's hull. It had the outboard motor mounted on it. She scrambled for the motor, pulling it closer to her, fighting to keep from being dragged under. Gulping for air and coughing, she pawed at the motor, yanking on it, starting it, pulling it loose. The outboard motor broke loose from the wreckage and started to sink. Jason looked up and saw the propeller blade spinning rapidly. He stared at the motor as it sank, coming directly at him. The spinning blade struck him, ripping through his neck and chest, boring into him like an auger, chewing through his flesh and sending a dark cloud of blood into the water. His hand unclasped Megan's foot. Megan coughed, sobbing and spitting out water, gasping for air. She grabbed Tommy once again and swam away as fast as she could, pulling for the shore. Jason's mangled corpse hung suspended in the dark waters of Crystal Lake, returned to its original underwater grave. As darkness closed in around him, the bloodlust abated and he stopped hearing the demon voice.
He felt no pain. Cool waters of the lake seemed soothing as they quenched the fires of his life. His last conscious thought was, maybe now they'll let me rest. Megan dragged Tommy's body ashore. The children came running down to her, surrounding her, as she bent over him and gave him mouth-to-mouth resuscitation, as she had been taught in life-saving class. She angled his head back and opened his mouth to clear it of any obstructions, making sure he hadn't swallowed his tongue. She pulled down his jaw, pinched his nostrils shut, took a deep breath, and exhaled into him. There was no response. She kept at it, refusing to accept that he was dead, trying to breathe life back into him, fighting back tears as she pushed down on his abdomen, desperately trying to revive him. Nancy watched Megan trying to bring Tommy back to life, and she closed her eyes, putting her hands together and whispering a prayer. Tears flowed down Megan's cheeks as she realized that it was useless. In an agony of fury and frustration, she struck Tommy's chest hard with her fist, hating him for dying and leaving her alone. Tommy coughed and spat out water. Megan cried out with joy and helped him to sit up. The children cheered. Little Nancy opened her eyes. When she saw that Tommy was all right, she looked up at the sky and smiled a thank you. Tommy looked up at Megan and smiled weakly. Overcome with relief, Megan threw her arms around him, hugging him close with all of her strength. Tommy looked out at the moonlit surface of Crystal Lake and sighed. He rested his head on Megan's shoulder and shut his eyes for a moment. The nightmares would not haunt him anymore. He had laid them all to rest once and for all. Even if he hadn't made it, it would have been worth it. But he had made it, thanks to Megan. He hugged her close as they sat wet and shivering upon the shore. "It's over, Megan," he said quietly, holding her. "It's finally over. Jason is home." The last burning piece of wood from the wrecked boat went out, and Crystal Lake was quiet again. The storm passed by and the wind died down. The sky was starting to turn gray as the survivors huddled together on the shore. It was almost dawn. Chapter 9. Martin crouched down over one of the graves in the Eternal Rest Cemetery, pulling up weeds. It was a warm day and the old caretaker worked slowly. No need to work up a sweat, he told himself, because these folks ain't no hurry. They sure ain't going anywheres. He chuckled at his own witticism. Yep, it sure is a good day, he thought. Sun shining down gently on a man's back, warming up his insides. Soft breeze blowing from the north. No forecast of rain for a change, so the arthritis wouldn't be acting up. And he had a full bottle of wild turkey waiting for when he finished up his chores. He sighed with contentment, grateful for the fact that his job was still secure. He'd be all right so long as he didn't ever have to sober up. A shadow fell across him, and the old alcoholic looked up, startled. A look of tense, frightened recognition passed over Martin's face, and he quickly dropped the weeds and struggled to his feet, dusting his palms off against one another. When he spoke, his voice was overly friendly. His manner, that of a fawning, servile dog. "You! You frightened me," he said, slouching, almost genuflecting. "I was just, you know, cleaning up the place, you know." The tall man in the dark suit stood motionless, silently staring down at the old caretaker. Martin squirmed beneath the directness of the gaze. "Nice to see you again, Mr. Voorhees," he said, bobbing his head, avoiding the man's eyes. "Haven't seen you in Crystal or Forest Green in quite some time." The thin, pale face was framed by long, dark red hair, heavily streaked with gray. It showed not a flicker of expression. The features were fine and chiseled, deeply etched. The mouth was thin and cruel, but the eyes... "Don't look at them eyes," thought Martin, "no matter what you do." "Hey, I've been taking real good care of your wife and son's graves," said Martin, his voice trembling slightly. "Go look, you'll be real pleased." Those eyes were like a snake's eyes, cold, feral, ancient. They made Martin think of mausoleums and crypts shrouded with cobwebs and covered with the dust of centuries. They made him think of beasts snarling and snapping at each other, teeth rending flesh and crunching bone. They made him feel as if 1,000 worms were writhing underneath his skin. The man silently reached into his back pocket, and his gnarled hand withdrew a wad of bills. Wordlessly, he handed the money to Martin, who took it gingerly, careful to touch only the wad of bills and not the claw-like hand.
Thank you, Mr. Voorhees. Thank you, Martin said, bowing and scraping like a serf before an aristocrat warlord.
His face averted, looking at the ground, at the man's feet, shrinking from the burning gaze of those ancient, baleful eyes.
I'll leave you in private like you... Okay, bye. Thank you.
The old drunken caretaker scuttled away between the tombstones, clutching his money like a starving dog hangs on to a bone. Sweet Jesus, he thought, sweat pouring off of him. Sweat that stank of sour mash. Thank God I got that grave cleaned up. He would have blamed me if he knew, but I cleaned it up. New sod and everything, and it looks good. Oh, thank God. Oh, Jesus, thank God.
Voorhees walked slowly between the rows of headstones, with a stately measured tread, almost gliding, like a dark predatory jungle cat. He stopped before the pair of tombstones, marking the graves of his wife and son. He stared for a long moment at the simple inscriptions. Then his gaze slowly traveled downward to stare at his son's grave. The burning eyes narrowed slightly as they bored intently into the mound of earth. He leaned closer, and his eyes grew wider, his pupils dilated. It seemed as if he was looking right down into the earth, his gaze penetrating the soil like X-rays, seeing the coffin of his son and the strange broken body that it held now, the corpse of Alan Hawes. Slowly, Jason's father straightened and turned to look after the old caretaker. Inside his shack, Martin upended the bottle of wild turkey and drank deeply, feeling the fire of the whiskey burn his throat, unable to stop shaking. He suddenly felt cold, as if someone had walked over his grave. He couldn't stop shivering. He sank down into the floor in the corner of his little shack, hugging the whiskey bottle to him with both arms, trembling like a leaf and saying over and over,
I swear I didn't, Mr. Voorhees. I didn't know, I swear.
Voorhees turned away, his eyes scanning the horizon, searching. His eyes traveled in the direction of the lake, several miles away, not visible from the cemetery. Crystal Lake was tranquil, sunlight sparkling on its bright blue surface, but underneath something started rising, something white, something that moved quickly toward the surface. The hockey mask bobbed up and floated on the surface of the lake, like a face gazing up at the bright sky with sightless eyes. For a moment everything was still, utterly still, like the silence of the grave or the calm before the storm. Then the wind picked up and swept across the lake, through the woods toward the town of Forest Green. A bank of thunderheads moved in, roiling the sky, and as the shadows lengthened, the tall, dark man silently turned and left the cemetery, slowly weaving back through the maze of tombstones like a specter.
The end. Okay, Slashaholics, this has been Friday the 13th, Part 6, Jason Lives, the novelization of the movie by Simon Hawke. I gotta say, guys, I was nothing but impressed with this entire book. Simon Hawke is a great author, and if this type of writing is what I have to look forward to whenever I narrate his Friday the 13th, Friday the 13th 2, and Friday the 13th 3 novels, then I am really looking forward to those because I love how he took the movie and still somehow added depth to it and took us beyond what we saw in the movie, took us into the heads of these characters, including Jason. That was pretty unique for a Jason book, you know, to go into his head and flashbacks of Jason and the like that. But, and what did you guys think of that ending? Mr. Elias Voorhees made an appearance.
That was originally supposed to be the ending to the movie as well. That would have been really awesome to actually see that. And have Elias Voorhees make an appearance at the end of the movie of Jason Lives. I will say another thing I liked about this book. It kind of solidified what I've always thought after watching Part 6. And that is Jason has no interest in killing small children. It's like he relates to them or something. It feels like at the end of the book, whenever he broke into that cabin, he was doing it to kind of bait Megan into showing up, you know, so he could go after her. I mean, he had so many chances in the movie and the book to just go through and murder these children in their cabins, and he didn't. And, you know, it's like he was mesmerized by Nancy, and then as soon as he saw somebody else, he went after them when he heard the noise. You know, he went back to killing the teenagers and grown-ups. But yeah, I really got no complaints about this book at all, guys. Like, I thought the kills were written spectacularly. I think a few questions that the movie had got answered. Tommy and Megan pretty much saved Cologne's life by locking him in that jail cell, if you think about it. Because he probably would have ended up out there dead, too. It does suck that her dad died. I never liked that her dad died, because they never really had a chance to patch up the little trip they were having. The little tryst they were having. You know, the rift between them. I got that tongue-tied. Rift and tryst. A rift and a tryst is a trift. Anyways, yeah, guys, I want to know what you guys thought of this book compared to the movie or just as its own entity. Your opinions on it. I'd love to hear from you guys in the comment section below. If you're listening to the unabridged version and you would like to hear me go in more depth on my review of this book, you can go back to the playlist for this book where I do one chapter per upload, and at the end of each of those uploads, I did a commentary for each chapter. I want to say thank you to my son, Anthony, my daughter, Alexis, and my niece, Stormy. Anthony and Stormy played a couple kids in the book that had a couple lines, and my daughter, Alexis Starr, she played Nancy. She voiced all of Nancy's lines. Thank you, Alexis, sweetheart. You did a really good job. And so did you, Anthony and Stormy. I love you guys. And as always, tonight's upload has been brought to you by our patrons on the Patreon page. And this unabridged version, if you're listening to it, has been brought to you by the patrons on the Patreon page. Carl Eakins, Catherine McClear, Cecilia Spears, Sean Campbell, and Hawaii. Thank you guys so much for your loyal dedication to the channel, sponsoring the channel through Patreon. And if anybody else loves this channel and the content I provide and wants to help the channel keep going and growing for years to come and dozens of books to come, then click that link in the description below, go to the Patreon page, sign up today for as low as $2 or $5 per month. You get early access to certain content on there. Regardless of the tier you pick, you will get the early access. And depending on the tier you select, there's some really awesome rewards for being a patron of the page. Check it out, guys. I think you'll enjoy it. And you'll be helping out the channel at the same time. All right, guys. Until next time, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80s slasher librarian saying, thanks for listening. On to book number 33. And have a great night, folks.
There's a lover in the story, but the story's still the same. There's a lullaby for suffering and a paradox to blame. But it's written in the scriptures and it's not some idle claim. I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker? We kill the flame.